Being here. Good morning. My name is Pamela Zelski, and for those of you who don't know me, I'm CAMS Advocacy Coordinator. I would like to welcome you today to CAMS' very first advocacy webinar, What to Know Before You Go, and thank you for joining us and being our guinea pigs today. Today I'll be updating you on our legislative appointments, and I'll also be sharing a lot of information with you about how best to prepare for those appointments. I want to give a big thank you to Jessica, who is on the line providing me with technical support, which is definitely not my strong suit. So she has everybody muted. What I'd like you to do, we will have plenty of time after the presentation to answer any questions that you might have. If something comes up and if you're afraid you're going to forget, please feel free to use the chat box, and then we can address questions or comments at the end of the presentation. I'm also hoping that some of our seasoned advocates who are on the line will want to jump in and share their tricks of the trade at the end of the presentation. Well, I'd like to note that you've already done the hardest part of participating by taking the first step and making the decision to join us here for this webinar. I know many of you have participated in an advocacy day before, either with CAM or with other organizations, and you have an idea of what to expect. But for some of you, this will be your very first advocacy day. And of course, the bills we'll be highlighting in our meetings this year will be new for everyone. My message to all of you is very simple. You will be ready. You will be prepared for your meetings simply by reviewing the advocacy toolkit that I sent out earlier this week, and by attending this webinar, you've taken the first step towards being prepared for Advocacy Day. And I hope you'll find the experience to be enjoyable and even fun. Before we begin, I'd like to thank the American Alliance of Museums for allowing me to use some of their materials, and I also want to thank Celeste and Jessica for their insight and, again, technical support in putting this together. Well, some of you might be wondering why we even hold an Advocacy Day. Why is this so important? And I can tell you that whenever I've been at the Capitol, both in Sacramento and in DC, I noticed many, many other groups walking the halls, making their case, visiting their legislators. And those of you who have attended an advocacy day before have probably noticed this as well. Everything from state parks to art groups, cancer awareness organizations, electrical contractors, they all hold their own advocacy days. You can even see evidence of this just by Googling the term advocacy day. And if you do this, you're going to be amazed with the list that comes up. There's a reason so many people hold their own advocacy days, and that's because telling stories can be very powerful. And that's really all advocacy is telling our personal stories. It makes an impact on the people listening to those stories, and it sticks with them. If you talk with legislative staff members, they will tell you that what they remember the most are those personal stories. And in many cases, when they need to reach out to a resource, they reach out to individuals who they made a connection with, someone who told them a story that was meaningful and impactful. On May 11th, at the end of the day, when the legislators and the staff members that we meet with think of museums, we want them to think about the stories we told them and to think of museums as vital, essential members in their community. As the people from AAM always say, if we're not at the table, we could be on the table. And we never, ever want to be in the position where an elected official says after the fact, "Oh, I wish I would have known this was going to hurt the museums in my district." It just really pays to be proactive. One final thought on this topic is that if you were suddenly elected to public office, who would you rather hear from? One of your constituents or a hired lobbyist? Constituents, hands down, win every time. I want us all to think about how much our elected officials really know about the museum field as a whole and how much they know about your museum in particular. Our legislative officials are overwhelmed with materials and information and requests every single day. This past year, I was part of a panel with Assemblymember Nora Campos at WMA. And one of the things that she talked about was a typical day for her. And I was really struck by the number of demands that she has to juggle every single day and everything she's expected to know and really expected to be an expert on. Elected officials have an incredible demand on their time and resources, and it's impossible for them to be an expert on every single issue and to know every resource in their district. And that's where all of you come in. By having these meetings, you are offering yourself as a resource to your legislator. And at the end of the day, we want to make sure that they know about your museum and the good work that you're doing in their district. But we also want them to remember you. So that way, when an issue comes up in the future and they need additional information, they'll remember meeting with that person from the aquarium, or that person from the zoo, or that person from the Natural History Museum. And they'll reach out to you and get their information that they need or ask their question. I'd like to start by talking about the program that we've put together for you. You'll start the day, of course, with the board meeting, and then over lunch, I'll be providing another orientation for you, which will primarily consist of talking about legislative updates on the bills that we'll be highlighting in our meetings, because things change from day to day. So where our bills are today may be completely different from where they are next week on May 11th. We'll also have a chance to address any questions or concerns that you may have, address any last-minute scheduling updates. You will also have a chance to talk and strategize with other board members who may be attending your meeting with you. And this is a really good time to figure out who's going to talk about which topic or who's going to leave the materials behind and so forth. That way you feel a little bit more smoothed and polished going into your meetings. In addition to the meetings, there will also be some other key events happening throughout the day that you'll want to attend if your schedule permits. So one thing, Micheline will be presenting the President's Award to Assemblymember Richard Bloom at some point during the day. The details are still being worked out, but it's something that you'll want to try to attend. There will also be a hearing on the Joint Committee for the Arts, which will be reviewing the latest OTIS report and creative economy research. This hearing is scheduled for 1:30, and if you don't already have an appointment for that time, I strongly encourage you to attend. Even if you can only stop by and stand in the back of the room for a little while and then hurry out to your next appointment, it's definitely an educational experience to see a legislative hearing in action. And from attending these hearings on the creative economy in the past, I can tell you that the information that is typically released is, quite frankly, fascinating, and I think it's something you'll really enjoy. Another potential hearing involves the bill that Cal Nonprofits has labeled as a bad bill, and that's AB 2855. This bill may be heard in the Assembly Appropriations Committee that day, and if it is, I may be asking at least some of you to attend part of the hearing and possibly even offer comments if you're comfortable doing so. At this point, nothing's been scheduled, but I do want to at least put it on your radar screen as a possibility. If you are asked to provide comments, please know that it would be something very simple and brief, and we would discuss it beforehand. So I don't want anybody to feel like they'd be going in blind to that. Finally, at the end of the day, we'll be having a reception. This year it will take place at the State Library. I really encourage you to attend this event if you can. We will be inviting the legislators and staff that we're meeting with during the date of the reception, and there will also be several of our state agency partners there as well. But most of all, it's a really great time just to check in with one another and talk about how the day went over food and drinks, and it's just a good time. Well, the legislative visits are really at the center of Advocacy Day, and I want to take some time to just talk about the logistics of those now. This year, for the very first time, we're scheduling all of the appointments for you, and I want to thank board Board Member and Government Relations Committee Member Christine Stokes, as well as Government Relations Committee Member Helen Alonzo, for helping me schedule these appointments. I could not have scheduled all these appointments by myself, and I am very grateful for these women for so generously donating their time so that we can offer this service to all of you. We have been busy behind the scenes scheduling lots of appointments, and as many of you know, the appointments are primarily constituency-based meetings. You'll be visiting with the assembly member and senator whose district includes your museum, and you'll also be paired with board members who are in the same district. In addition, we've identified other key legislators who we'll be meeting with, and in many cases, you might be asked to attend one or more of these meetings, particularly if your institution serves that legislator's general area. In some cases, you'll be attending these meetings alone, and in other cases, you could be going into a meeting with other board or staff members. If you're scheduled alone and you'd like someone to accompany you to your meetings, please don't be shy. Let me know, and I will do my best to pair you up with either a member of the Government Relations Committee or another board member or staff member who's a seasoned advocate. And even if it's the last minute, a couple days beforehand, if you're feeling anxious, please shoot me an email, give me a call, and we'll do what we can to get you paired up. One final practical point. Wear comfortable shoes. I know that probably sounds silly, but you'll be doing a lot of walking that day, and as someone who's walked the halls of the Capitol in uncomfortable shoes, fashion is not worth it, so you want to be comfortable. We're also trying to do our best to give you a reasonable amount of time between appointments, but sometimes that's not possible. So there are a few of you that may have a couple of appointments that you may be rushing to, and I apologize for that. Just sometimes it can't be helped. I've emailed some of you with notices of appointments. These are tentative schedules because things often change at the last minute at the Capitol. If you haven't received an appointment email, don't worry. Please know we're still working on them and you'll receive it shortly. I will have a final schedule available for all of you at Advocacy Day, a hard copy, and that will have the time of the meeting, the room number, who you're meeting with, whether it's the legislator or staff, and then the other board members or staff members who are attending your meeting. I'll also include my personal cell number on that sheet so that in case you need to reach me during the day, you'll have contact information. I will ask that if you have changes to your schedule and you can't make all of your meetings, please let me know as soon as possible so that way we can make necessary adjustments to our master schedule. So that's enough, I think, about the logistics of the meeting. And I'd like to now kind of shift gears and talk about the most important part of these visits, and that's the substance. This year we have chosen three bills to target, and they're listed here on your screen for you, along with our ask. Your toolkit includes a 1-to-2-page sheet that summarizes the bill and our ask, and then highlights some talking points to help you when you're in your meetings. I strongly recommend going through this prior to the meetings on the 11th. The first bill in the packet is AB 2674, and this bill establishes an online art state archives program. The bill is straightforward, the fact sheet and CAM's letter of support are both in your packet, and our ask here is very simple. We simply want them to support this bill. I will note that it's important to point out that while we are supporting this bill, our support is conditional in that we interpret, based on the plain language of the bill, that the online state archives program would only require the state archives participation. In other words, the bill does not require other collecting institutions, such as museums, to participate. Don't worry, you don't have to memorize all that. It's in the letter and it's in your talking points. The next bill that we're going to be addressing is AB 2855, charitable solicitations. And again, our ask here is very simple, except this time we want them to oppose the bill. I would review both our fact sheet as well as the fact sheet from Cal Nonprofits that I included in your toolkit. This bill would require nonprofit organizations to place unnecessary notices on every document that includes a fundraising message. And I would encourage you to think beforehand about what this might mean for your institution and share that concern with the person you're meeting with. I want to point out that over 600 nonprofits have come out in opposition to the bill, and no organization has supported it. And that's just unheard of. That simply does not happen to have such a skewed level of support. So why I'm bringing this up is the person that you're meeting with will have likely heard this message loud and clear from other organizations, but it's important to remember that we should be keeping our comments respectful, so not going in, even though Cal Nonprofits has called this a bad bill, probably not going in and labeling it a bad bill in your meeting is a good idea, and keep your comments succinct, but try to stress the personal impact that this bill could have on your organization. The final bill that we'll be addressing is the Organized Camps Bill, SB 476. This bill redefines the term organized camps to include an organized residence camp and an organized day camp, and provides activities that promote environmental awareness and education. In my opinion, that's a pretty broad definition. The recharacterization of the term camp would require them to follow existing public health and safety codes. Why we care about this bill is that many of you host programs during the summer that you label for marketing purposes as camps. There was a partial exemption in the bill for programs operated by museums, and that version was passed in the Senate. It was removed, however, by the Assembly Health Committee, but not because anyone believes that museums fall under the umbrella of the bill. I don't think anyone believes that. The Health Committee doesn't, the author's office doesn't, and the bill's sponsor doesn't. But that could be the unintended consequence if this bill is not amended. So our ask here is a bit more nuanced. We want this bill to be amended to reflect the true intent that programs operated by museums are not to fall under the scope of the bill. You'll also notice, in addition to these legislative priorities, that there are policy briefs that are included in the packet. These have lots of great information about important public policies like the economy, education, water conservation, and so forth. Use your best judgment and try to relate the material in that packet to personal stories that you'll be sharing about your museum. You can also try to relate it to the person that you're meeting with. So, for example, talking about the economic piece is a good call when you're meeting with a Republican legislator. These meetings are not long. So if you feel like there's time to address a few of the points in the policy briefs, go ahead. But if you don't get to it, don't worry. You'll be leaving the policy briefs behind, and they can review them at their leisure if they choose to do so. I also want to share with you how I really envision a legislative meeting, kind of a game plan of the meeting, if you will. And this is not intended to be a rigid format, and depending on how the meeting is going, the flow or the order will be different. And that's okay. This is more to give you an idea of what elements should be a part of your meeting. With that said, the first element of any meeting is to introduce yourself and make a connection. Establish a rapport. Legislators and staffers are extraordinarily busy people, and in most cases, these meetings are going to be short. They may even take place in odd locations. and it helps to be flexible and simply go with the flow. I've met with legislators and staffers in waiting rooms, hallways, have had to make my case while walking from one appointment to the next. The point is, you won't have a lot of time, so it's important to do your best to make that human connection right from the beginning. One of the ways to do this is to start by saying thank you. It could be as simple as thanking them for supporting the Snoopy license plate program. And the policy brief on the Snoopy plate and museum grant program has some language that you can use. You can also kind of tailor your thank you. For example, some of you will be meeting with the staffer to Assemblymember Bonta, who's the author for the State Archives Bill. So you could start that meeting by thanking them for introducing the State Archives Bill. Then you want to make your case. And this is where you present your argument. So go through the bills, again briefly, and make your ask, whether it's support, oppose, or amend. You also want to tell your story about your institution, and I think this is really one of the most important pieces. Are you offering a unique program? Did you just open a new exhibit? How are children and families in their district touched by what your museum is doing? You'll find that legislators love museums. They really do. And they want to know what you're doing. It really is such a breath of fresh air to have somebody from a museum in their district come in when they're barraged with all sorts of requests throughout the day. They really enjoy talking with us. You may also want to pick one of the policy statements, depending on the legislator's interest, and then relate it back to them. So, for example, you could say, given the assembly member's interest in technology and innovation, we hope to have his support on the State Archives Bill. And you'll, of course, done your homework, and you'll know to make those connections. And we'll go through that in a little bit. After you've done all that, then we're going to listen up. In rare instances, you may make your ask and the staff member simply says, okay. But in most cases, they're going to follow up with something. Take notes, try to address their concerns the best you can. If you don't know the answer, that's okay. There's no need to panic. It simply tell them that you'll need to do some additional research and get back to them, but make sure you get their card and then you can follow up later with an email. One important nuance I want to underscore is where these bills are. All of these bills right now are in the assembly. And that's important because your ask is going to be slightly different depending on if you're meeting with an assembly member or a senator. If you're meeting with an assembly member, we simply make the ask. For instance, support the State Archives Bill or oppose charitable solicitations. If we're meeting with a senator, we want to preface our ask with when or if the bill gets to the Senate. You'll note that there's a link on the bottom of this slide, and that's to a 5-minute video that AAM has created that they use in their training for Advocacy Day in Washington, D.C. These slides that we're looking at right now will all be emailed to you, and I would encourage you to watch this video on your own at some point prior to the 11th. The issues, of course, are different, but I think it really illustrates what these meetings look like and how quickly things really unfold. Whether you've never done this before or whether you've done this 300 times, we learn something every time we watch other advocates. I know I do, and I hope you'll find the video to be instructive. In order to be able to have a meeting that goes well, we have to be prepared. And that means not only reviewing the material in the toolkit, but also doing some other things to be prepared. Your Advocacy Day homework, if you will. I want to say at the outset, this is a huge list. I realize that you are all busy people and you will not get to everything on the list, and that's fine. I created it, though, not to overwhelm you, but because different things work for different people. This is simply meant to give you some ideas. I personally like to look at the legislator's official website. I really focus on their biography. This is the information the legislator wants the general public to know about themselves. I also look at the press release to see what's up, press releases rather, to see what's on their mind and what might be keeping them up at night. There's generally a link to press releases on their official website as well. In most cases, their committee assignments will be listed on their website, and that also will give you a good idea about what their interests are. Checking their social media pages is a good way to find out what's on their mind, and it also will give you some insight into their ideologies. This is particularly helpful if you're meeting with someone who you don't really know all that well or who isn't your legislator. And finally, simply Googling your legislator is an easy and helpful way to see what the press is saying about them. And you can bet that the staffer you're meeting with is going to be familiar with everything that's been said about their boss in the media that week. I will generally review most of these things that are on the legislator's official website, and then I'll make an outline just for myself about key points that come up while I'm doing this research. That way it's easy for me to recall the information when I'm in a meeting and something related comes up. Now, that being said, you may do all this research, and that doesn't mean that you're going to use all of it, but at least it's in your head, and that way if you kind of have to pull things out, you're prepared to do so. You will also have some leave-behind materials, and these materials that you can leave behind in either the assembly member or senator's office will include a nice two-page informational sheet about California museums, the legislative briefs, the policy statements, and a hard copy of the invitation to our reception at the State Library. Please remember to invite each and every staff member or legislator that you meet with to our reception. Well, I want to just summarize a few points that have come up from year to year concerning the legislative visits. As I mentioned previously, your schedule will give you all of the information you need about your meeting. In many cases, you will be meeting with staff. They are overworked and underpaid, but they are also dedicated and carrying a large caseload. Treat them with respect, no matter how young they look. There's a tendency, I think, to want to meet with the legislator and to be somewhat disappointed when your meeting is just, when we say just with a staff person. However, I want to underscore, and I can't underscore this enough, that meeting with staff is sometimes better than meeting with the legislator. They're the eyes and ears of the legislator. They're a tremendous resource. Elected officials depend on them to provide them with information that they need to make important voting decisions. And they can be a great internal champion for your cause. A legislative meeting is also not the time to get into a political debate with someone. If it's clear that you're not on the same page as the person you're meeting with, simply make your points politely, thank them for their time, and move on. During the visit, make sure to get a card from everyone you meet with as well, and leave your card. This will be helpful when you're doing your thank you notes later, as well as for any other future communication you want to have with that office. I would recommend bringing extra cards with you to Sacramento so that way you don't have to worry about running out. And finally, I want to stress that we should be making an ask at every meeting, even if it's just to invite them to the reception or invite them to visit your museum. This may seem strange to some of you, but they really are expecting it, and it's part of the reason you're there. I'd like to talk about another tool in your toolbox to maximize your advocacy day experience, and that's social media. No matter how you might feel about social media personally, it is a very effective advocacy tool, and it's here to stay. You can even start now by liking or following your legislators. Please remember to post photos and positive comments about your visit. Please also share information on multiple platforms. So if you're just a Facebook user, try, you know, maybe posting photos on Instagram or comments on Twitter. And that way, all of your followers will know what you're up to. You can also post both before and after your visit. So you might want to tweet about how you're looking forward to the visit, or you can thank staff for their time after the visit. Please also do your research and be sure that you're tagging your legislators accurately. If you're posting a lot of positive comments about your elected official, you want to be sure that you're tagging them correctly so he or she can see all the nice things you're saying about them. Well, I realize I've just thrown a ton of information at you. I'm sure you're all probably getting tired of listening to me talk. I want you to take some time between now and May 11th to review the materials and really just let them sink in. It's a lot of information to process, and sometimes I think it's just a matter of jumping in, having the meeting, and realizing that you really can do this. I'd like to open up the lines for questions and comments at this time, and I'm hoping that some of our more seasoned advocates in the group will want to share their best practices or tips that they've found to be helpful to them.
Vicki, I just wanted to say that I know the first time when I did this a couple of years ago, it seemed overwhelming, especially kind of fumbling for the different paperwork and making sure you had all your notes and being prepared, but once you're doing it, it feels very natural, and it's not really as overwhelming as it might seem beforehand, so I'm looking forward to doing it again.
Thank you, Nikki. Well, and I think sometimes, you know, legislators a lot of times are meeting with high-powered, positive, or high-powered, polished, I should say, lobbyists. And so if you are kind of stumbling and you're feeling a little bit nervous, that's okay. In a lot of respects, it's very refreshing and real for them. Does anybody else have any questions or comments, observations?
Pamela, this is Jennifer. I have a quick question.
Sure.
First of all, I wanted to thank you very much for this material. I feel 1,000% more prepared than I was last year. So already I'm feeling great about Advocacy Day this year. I will say that in going through your packet, I had a couple of kind of questions that sort of popped up for me.
Sure.
One was like the online archives program bill. I didn't know if there was going to be any information about the potential financial impact on the state of that, or I'm just trying to kind of run through the questions that might stump me, you know. So do you have any information on those sorts of things, or should we just steer clear and stay on message and, you know, I don't know.
As far, when you say impact on the state, are you talking cost?
Yes. Like, is
okay.
There any, you know, this
well,
quarter,
and-
Yeah,
absolutely.
No.
And I will have some additional information about that, or I will try to get some additional information on those points between now and when we meet, and we can talk about that hopefully at the orientation. I do know right now it's in suspense file, and which basically kind of means it's holding, and that's the reason, is because of the potential cost. So I think that's a good point. It could potentially come up. I think it's likely, and we definitely want to be prepared. So my hope is to get some additional information about that and provide you with that at orientation.
Okay, great. Thank you. specific questions regarding the bills, but I think at orientation, I would encourage everybody to kind of make notes in the margins and ask Pamela questions during that orientation. It really helps a lot.
And as you're reviewing things after this webinar, please, and you know, if you feel like you don't want to wait until the orientation on the 11th, please send me an email or give me a call. I'm happy to talk to people about specifics, or if you want to kind of run through some things that are more personal to your institution and even have somebody to bounce ideas off, please feel free to reach out. I'm happy to talk to people.
This is Celeste, and I think that that's very helpful to kind of what you just said, Jennifer, about making sure that you kind of write down what your notes are and so that you can ask for the information when we meet face-to-face, because we will have the opportunity for Pamela to give us updates on where the bills are. I think also, it might be a little bit overwhelming for people who are new to this, but for people who have done it before and are looking for maybe going to that next level, there is a way for you to see, if you search online, you can find the staff analysis. So every bill has a staff analysis that goes to the committee members prior to it being heard in a committee or a hearing. And that oftentimes is very helpful because it has that nitty-gritty information such as budget impacts. It also has who's supporting the bill, who's opposing the bill. And it can be very helpful if you want to kind of do that deep dive. So maybe when you send out these slides for those people who want to go a little bit deeper, then you can provide a link to where they can search for by bill number. That might be helpful.
Absolutely. That's very easy to find.
Yeah, because then you can look by author, you can search by author, you can search by bill number, and sometimes it is it's interesting to look by author because you can look by who you're meeting with and see what other bills that they are sponsoring. But not to sidetrack you, because we do want you to be focused in these meetings on what's of interest in the museum field, but just like Pamela said, that the bios are interesting, their websites are interesting, it kind of gives you a snapshot of what they care about. I was going to say, because you were saying, Pamela, about, you know, picking and choosing what research you do beforehand and what's most useful to you. I find, for me, some of the most useful information is what committees they serve on, because that will also tell you whether or not they're going to see this bill at some point. Some of these bills, they may only vote on it when it goes to the Assembly or Senate floor. Other bills they will see prior to it going to the floor. So it is helpful sometimes to kind of know that prior to the meeting. Thank you.
Thanks, Celeste. Well, I think if that's all, I again want to thank you for joining us. I hope you found it to be helpful. I'm excited to see all of you in Sacramento next week. And again, if you have other questions, please feel free to email me or give me a call. We're going to have an absolutely fantastic advocacy day. Thank you.